Hey everyone, Tiffany here from the Developer Advocacy Team at Zendesk. In this video, we're going to be talking about webhooks. We'll take a look at what webhooks actually are, how they function, and how to use them at Zendesk. We'll also set up a couple of webhooks, first in the Zendesk Admin Center UI, where we'll see how we can create cards in the popular project management tool Trello. Then using the Webhooks API, we'll work with the GitHub API to raise issues in a repository. Super excited for this one, so with that, let's get started. You might have heard of them in the past and wonder what they are, or you might interact with them on a daily basis. But what are webhooks and how do they work? At their core, webhooks are a way that you can send information to a specified URL automatically in response to events. This happens by way of user-defined HTTP callbacks. All this means is that the user will specify the content of the payload and the URL that the content should be sent, and the webhook will take care of the rest when a specified event takes place. Say, for example, you have a workflow in Zendesk where any time a new ticket is submitted, you'd like to record the email address of the requester in an external database. You can set up a trigger which fires an action to notify the webhook when a new ticket is received. You then provide the email address of the webhook, and that will be sent as a post request to the external database. Webhooks aren't just limited to post requests either. There are many different ways you can utilize webhooks when working with Zendesk, and we'll go over some of those here next. So, how do webhooks work at Zendesk? Webhooks are used by automations and triggers in Zendesk support when a ticket meets specific conditions. For example, you could create a webhook to alert your team in Slack when an urgent ticket is created. Or you could update a card in Jira with common updates received on a ticket in Zendesk. Creating webhooks in Zendesk is super easy, whether that be in your admin center or via the Webhooks API. After creating the business rules that will execute the action to notify your webhook, you simply need to set up the webhook by entering a name, description, and endpoint URL. Next, you'll select the request method and request format. And lastly, you'll select the authentication type required for the request. And that's all there is to it. Your webhook is ready to be associated with the appropriate automation or trigger. Next, we'll go ahead and see how to set up our own webhook in Admin Center. Okay, let's work through setting up our own webhook here in Zendesk support. Here's a scenario. We have a bunch of tickets being created in our Zendesk account, but we'd also like to create cards in the popular project management tool Trello when a ticket meets certain conditions. How do we go about that? Webhooks, of course. So to start, let's head over to the Admin Center. On the left-hand side, you'll see a panel with a few different options. We'll go ahead and click the Apps and Integration section and select Webhooks. If this is your first time opening the Webhooks page, you'll see the Getting Started page, which outlines creating a webhook and converting HTTP targets to webhooks. If you're seeing the Getting Started page, go ahead and click Create Webhook at the bottom. Otherwise, click Actions at the top right and select Create Webhook. This brings us to the configuration page for our webhook. This is where you'll enter all the required information, such as name, endpoint URL, request method, and authentication. Since this webhook will be creating a card in Trello, let's name this webhook Create Trello Card. While optional, adding a description is a great way to quickly remember what each webhook does. This becomes more important as you add more and more webhooks. We'll go ahead and add a description for our webhook here now. Next up is the endpoint URL, which describes where the data will be passed to integrate with the third-party service. Since we're integrating with the Trello API to create a card, we'll go ahead and enter the endpoint now. If you're not familiar with Trello and its API and you'd like to follow along, I'll put a link in the description where you can learn the basics of using the Trello API. The Trello API endpoint URL takes in query parameters to provide data when creating the card. Here, you'll see the parameter of name, which will be the title of the card. How do we ensure that the name parameter is being updated based on the data from the ticket is being triggered by? For this, we'll use placeholders. Placeholders are containers for dynamically generated ticket data. I won't go into too much detail here since placeholders are out of the scope of this video, but I'll drop a link in the description below if you'd like to find out more. For now, let's go ahead and add a placeholder value to the name parameter in the endpoint URL. We'll add the ticket.title placeholder, which will result in the title of the card in Trello corresponding to the ticket subject line from Zendesk. Next up is a request method. You want to select the appropriate request method from this drop-down list, depending on the action your webhook is designed to accomplish. In our case, since we're creating a card on our Trello board, we'll go ahead and select Post. Next up is the Request format. This describes the format of the payload your webhook will pass along with the request. Again, depending on the action of your webhook and the endpoint you're interacting with, you'll select from the list of either JSON, XML, or form encoded. For our purposes, we can go ahead and leave this as JSON. Last but not least, we have authentication. Webhooks use authentication to securely integrate with destination systems and signing secrets to verify the integrity of the requests. Here, you'll see the three options that webhooks support: no authentication, basic authentication, and bearer token. Basic authentication takes a username and password, which will be provided by the third-party service you're interacting with. Bearer token is where you'll enter an OAuth access token to authenticate the webhook if the third-party service is secured using OAuth. Again, the endpoint you're interacting with will determine the type of authentication you should be using here. In our case, the endpoint authentication credentials are provided in the endpoint URL, so we can leave none selected. And that's it. We can go ahead and test our webhook now to make sure everything is working correctly before creating it. Let's go ahead and click the Test Webhook button, and you should see a pane appear off to the right with a few different options and fields. The first option is Test Event Source. This describes a test source for the request, essentially what is sent in the request body of the payload. You can either leave it as a sample support ticket with a mock ticket payload, or you can select Custom Test and write your own request body in the field below. In this case, we'll keep the sample support ticket payload. Since we have a placeholder present in our endpoint URL, you'll also see a field to enter a value for that here. As mentioned earlier, this value is dynamically generated from the ticket data, but since this test is not associated with a real ticket, it doesn't have a value to pull, so we'll go ahead and add a test value here. And that's all there is to it. We'll go ahead and click Send Test, and we should see the response status appearing along with the response body and response headers. If everything went well, you'll see a 200 status returned. We can confirm this has all functioned as expected by heading over to our Trello board, where we'll see the new card created with the title we set in the test fields. Now that we have our webhook set up and have tested to make sure it's functioning correctly, how do we go about notifying the webhook to fire? We can do this through triggers and automations. Triggers and automations are business rules that result in actions that you define based on certain conditions. Triggers fire as a result of conditions you set, such as when a ticket status changes or if a ticket has a tag added to it. Automations are similar to triggers but are time-based and execute every hour instead of in response to conditions. Triggers and automations are a whole subject that we've covered in previous videos. So if you'd like to learn more, I've dropped a link in the description below that goes into more detail. For now, I've gone ahead and set up a trigger that will notify our webhook when certain conditions are met. You'll see that we've set the first condition as ticket is created. This means the trigger will only fire if the status of the ticket is new. Second, we've set a condition where the ticket must have a tag associated with it called Trello. At the bottom of the customization page, you'll see the actions section. This is where you'll set the action to execute if the conditions we have set have been met. We've selected Notify Active Webhook from the dropdown on the left, and on the right, we've selected the webhook that we created earlier. You'll notice that there is a field called JSON body, which has been left blank. Since the Trello API endpoint has been passed the data via URL query parameters, there is no need to add a JSON body. If you are interacting with an API endpoint that takes a JSON body to pass the data, you would add that information here. Okay, with all the conditions and actions set on our trigger, we're ready to test it out on a ticket. In Zendesk support, let's go ahead and create a new ticket. We'll add a subject, as well as a short description. Next, and importantly, we'll add a tag called Trello. Remember, this is one of the conditions we set in our trigger to fire the action of notifying our webhook. Now, let's hit Submit as new, and if everything went well, we'll see the new card in Trello with the title reflecting the subject line of our ticket. We can also check the activity of our webhook by heading back to our admin center, clicking the settings icon next to our webhook, and heading to the details section. Under event subscription, we can see the trigger our webhook was attached to, and under activity, we can see a log of when our webhook has been fired and whether the response was a success or failure. And that wraps up the basics of getting a webhook up and running in Admin Center. But Admin Center is just one way you can create and configure webhooks. Next up, we'll look at how we can set up webhooks using the Zendesk Webhook API. The Webhook API lets you manage webhooks and enable subscriptions to receive notifications about Zendesk events. As with webhooks created in the Admin Center UI, you can use webhooks created via API together with triggers and automations to send a notification when a ticket is created or updated. We'll also specify a name, endpoint URL, request method and format, and authentication type, similarly to how we did in our previous scenario. We can even run our tests and check for successful invocation of our webhook or using the API. One thing to note, the Webhooks API is allowed for users with admin or above level permissions in your Zendesk account. If your profile doesn't have admin or above permissions, your Zendesk administrator may be able to help with getting you set up. In this example, we'll be connecting to the popular version control service, GitHub. Here's the scenario. Our support center has received reports of a bug in one of our technical products. After verifying the reports are accurate, we'd like to open an issue on our GitHub repository of the product. How do we go about this quickly and easily without leaving the Zendesk workflow? You guessed it, with webhooks. Let's work through how we can set up a webhook to do this for us using the API. For the purposes of this walkthrough, we'll be working out of Postman. If you're not familiar with Postman and you'd like to follow along, I've put a link in the description that will get you up to speed. First things first, in Postman, let's go ahead and set up our request. We'll start off by entering the webhook API endpoint in the URL field here. Since we're creating a new webhook, this will be a post request, so we'll go ahead and update the method to post. And quick side note, if you're wanting to show or update an existing webhook, you'd use get or put. Next up, we'll go ahead and add our authorization. We'll select basic auth from the drop-down list and add our Zendesk username and password. In my case, Postman has pre-filled this for me already. If your account uses API tokens for authentication, you can enter that in the password field in the email/token format. And that's all we need for the basic structure of our request. Now, we'll go ahead and click the body tab to begin adding the payload of our request, which will contain all the information we need to get our webhook set up. We'll be sending this request body in a JSON format, so we'll go ahead and select raw from the buttons at the top. And from the drop-down list on the right, we'll select JSON. Now, as I mentioned earlier, we'll still need to add all the information that we had included in the Admin Center UI example, except this time, we're adding the information as JSON. First up is creating the webhook object that will contain the data. Within the webhook object, we'll define the properties of our webhook and their value. First up is a name for the webhook, which we'll call GitHub Issue Creator. Next, we'll add a description. Again, while optional, adding a description is a great way to quickly remember what each webhook does, so in this case, we'll add a short description to the webhook. Next, we'll add the endpoint URL. Remember, this is a URL of the endpoint that our webhook will be interacting with. In our case, we'll be wanting to make a request to the GitHub API to create the issue, so we'll go ahead and add that here. The GitHub repository will need to be dynamic based on a value provided in a ticket form field. So we'll go ahead and add a placeholder to the GitHub URL in place of a static value. Now we can go ahead and add our HTTP method, request format, and status. Since we're creating a new issue, we'll go ahead and set the HTTP method to a post request. The GitHub API takes a JSON payload, so we'll set the request format to JSON. And we'll be wanting to use this webhook immediately, so we'll go ahead and set the status to active. Next up, we'll need to add our authentication for the request. We'll create an authentication object, which will contain a couple of child objects to authenticate our request. Creating an issue in GitHub using the API requires OAuth authorization, so I'll go ahead and add our token here within a data object. Under the type property, we'll specify that we're using a bearer token. Finally, we'll define the add position of the authentication object as header. This is essentially just telling the API that the authentication object needs to go within the header of the request when the webhook fires. Again, depending on the endpoint you're interacting with, you could use basic auth, OAuth, or omit the authorization object entirely for no authentication. The last property we'll add here is subscriptions. This lets your webhook know to listen for conditions that we set in our trigger or automation. The value this property takes is an array containing a string conditional ticket events. And that's it. We can go ahead and click send in Postman, and if everything went to plan, we should see a 201 created response together with a response body that will contain our webhook ID. We can also confirm this by heading to our webhooks in Admin Center, where we'll see the webhook we created via API now appearing. As we did when creating a webhook in Admin Center, the last step is setting our trigger action to notify the webhook when the conditions of the trigger are met. I've created a trigger ahead of time, so let's go ahead and set the action to notify the webhook. In Admin Center, we'll click through to our triggers and select Create GitHub Issue. The first condition you'll see is that the ticket status is less than solved. This means any active ticket that is not in a solved state will meet the condition. The second condition you'll see checks whether the issue tag is present on the ticket. And finally, you'll see a condition GitHub repository present. GitHub repository is a custom drop-down field that contains a list of repository names that are used together with a placeholder in the GitHub API URL. We're checking here if a form value is present. Okay, let's go ahead and add our action. We'll select Notify Active Webhook, and then we'll select our webhook from the drop-down list. Remember the JSON body section we went over earlier in this video? This time, we'll be adding some JSON using placeholders here that'll be sent as the payload to the GitHub API. I'll add that JSON in here now, hit the Create button at the bottom right, and we're done. We can head over to a ticket to test by adding the issue tag to our ticket, selecting our repository from the drop-down field here. Enter a ticket subject and description, and hitting save. If we head over to our GitHub repository and check the issues tab, we should see the new issue now appearing. And that wraps up creating a webhook using the Zendesk Webhooks API. In this video, we learned what webhooks are and how they function at Zendesk. We worked through how to set up webhooks, first in your Zendesk Admin Center, then in Postman using the Webhooks API. Finally, we saw how triggers and automations work together with webhooks to send data from Zendesk to a third-party service. Webhooks are an incredibly versatile tool that greatly expand what's possible for you to do with Zendesk. If you'd like to continue learning more about webhooks and their capabilities, I've put some resources in the description below that'll get you started. And as always, if there's anything else you'd like us to cover in future videos, please leave a comment below. Thanks so much for watching, and see you in the next one.